Interestingly enough, you can be, quote, white and have Native American ancestry. I mean, it's almost fashionable nowadays. Cher, the 70-plus-year-old singer, she claims to be Cherokee. I can't think of all of these people. I think Elizabeth Warren also claimed to be Cherokee, and her whiteness credentials were not challenged. But I think this has something to do with the fact that that stems from access to land. That is to say, that if these people who are considered white or also have Native American ancestry, that means they can have an easier claim to the land. Whereas if you're, no, nobody could, you're not considered to be part black, you're either black or you're not. I mean, you could look like Peter. And if you have one ancestor stretching back 15 generations who was African, you're black. Anti-blackness, which I'm afraid to say has penetrated certain levels of the wage earning class. I mean, if you look at the US Civil War, for example, the foot soldiers for the slave owning class were mostly settlers from the wage earning class. And they were fighting to maintain a system of enslavement whereby unpaid workers could undercut them. It's hard to compete against, if you're a wage earning carpenter, if a carpenter is not receiving a wage. So they were basically fighting against their interests, their own interests. And therein, you begin to see some of the contradictions of the US working class, which have persisted to this very day. No,
Okay.
it's very serious. I mean, the US, the corporate media, the US press has been running these stories about what they call Blaxit, a play on Brexit. Because, black people, are beginning to flee already, because
Yeah.
we know that we're going to be, we're in a counter-revolutionary moment. I mean, part of the problem is because of a misreading of history and a misreading of this notion of counter-revolution, there is not an awareness of how there can be a counter-revolutionary moment today. And as I said, accomplished by fair means or foul. That is to say, if you don't win at the ballot box, you win in the streets, for example, as was attempted on January 6, 2021.
So we have the honor to interview Professor Horne again. He is the Morris Professor of History and African American Studies at the University of Houston. Professor Horne is a prolific author and a leading scholar in the fields of African American history, labor history, and the US foreign policy. And his work has shed light on the complex intersection of race, class, and power, and has made significant contributions to our understanding of the African diaspora and the global struggle for racial justice. I think Professor Horne now has written approximately 50 books or so. It's an intimidating amount of books. And in addition to his scholarly work, Professor Horne has also been a frequent commentator on social and political issues. I always follow your analysis on world affairs on the Activist News Network. And what I always like about your style is that you give a lot of context, also historical context to contemporary issues, contemporary geopolitical issues. So today I would like to we will we would like to discuss a couple of things in relation to white supremacy and maybe a bit about how that history continues to shape global issues and struggles for justice. So let me begin with a bit of a broad question if that is okay. And that is that in your work you often discuss how European settlers in America united under the banner of whiteness. You would even call it the European Union was already there in the United States, which I really like that comparison. And could you maybe elaborate a bit on how this process unfolded and what factors contributed to the formation of a shared white identity? And then I have a bit of an extra question that has always been on my mind. as a Dutch person, some scholars would argue that the concept of whiteness and white supremacy emerged earlier during European colonialism in other parts of the world by the confrontation with other people classified as non-white. To what extent do you think that earlier colonial encounters between Europeans and people of color laid the groundwork for the development of white supremacy?
Well, first of all, what do you mean by earlier? What time period are you referring to?
Well, maybe not even earlier, but independently. Let's say independently. So when the Europeans, for example, when the Dutch were in Indonesia or something, and that encounter between Dutch and non-white Indonesians independently also formed a kind of distinction between whiteness and people who were classified as non-white. Independently, I would say, of the idea of Europeans coming together in the United States and forming, therefore forming a one white identity.
Of course, of course. First of all, to clarify, a lot of my work deals not only with London, but with Protestantism. Mm-hmm. And to the extent that your ancestors were Protestant, I think that they're implicated in the larger narrative that I'm telling. The larger narrative that I'm telling basically begins in the 15th century with the folks we refer to as the Ottoman Turks ousting those who had been occupying what is now Istanbul, Constantinople, which injects quite a bit of fear and hysteria in the Christian world, which basically means the Catholic world. In other words, this is an era of religious conflict, religion being a major marker of society. And we all know the story about 1492, not only Columbus sailing the ocean blue, but the people we refer to as the Spaniards finally ousting the Muslims from controlling a good deal of what is now we would call Spanish territory. And then, of course, the acceleration of the Inquisition, which targets the Jewish population. So, in fact, as I suggest in my book on the 16th century, there's evidence to suggest that when Columbus sailed the ocean blue, that escaping from the Iberian Peninsula were some we would refer to as Sephardim, that is to say, Iberian Jewish folk. Now, that means that in terms of the rise of Europe, it's imbricated in the depredations inflicted upon the indigenous people of the Americas in the first instance, not only the genocide, but also the loot being the wealth of the Americas. And then, of course, they also begin to accelerate the African slave trade. But what is somewhat distinctive about the Iberians is that they took Catholicism very seriously. And one could be an African and be a conquistador, be a conqueror, for example. I cite a number of examples in my book on the 16th century. But then this turning point comes in 1517 with the rise of Martin Luther, the Protestant secession from the Catholic Church, takes London by storm by the 1530s. I'm sure your audience is familiar with the stories about Henry VIII. Eventually has influence even in France with the so-called Huguenots and, of course, in Holland as well, which inaugurates a round robin of religious wars and religious conflicts between the Protestants and the Catholics. As I tell the story, the Protestants were the scrappy underdog. If you look at London, for example, they had expelled their Jewish population at the end of the 13th century, circa 1291, in the so-called Christian era. But being under siege, they had to make hasty compromises. And therein, you begin to see the creation of this monetized and militarized identity politics of whiteness. That is to say, those who had been at odds, Christians and Jewish not least, begin to unite on a common platform. And of course, it reaches its zenith in North America, not least because the Spaniards, with the first mover's advantage, had already established a foothold in the territory heading south from Mexico or west to Cuba, heading southward into South America. And of course, the Iberian comrades, the Portuguese, had occupied what is now Brazil. And so in North America, it was the place for contestation. And as you know, there was a sharp contestation between the Spaniards in London and what is now Florida. The Spaniards had arrived there as early as 1565, for example. But given the fact that Florida is now part of the United States, you can readily infer that the Spaniards eventually were ousted from Florida, which takes place circa 1819, 1820, during the US era. So in any case, these scrappy underdogs, speaking of the Protestants, speaking of England, I would say almost in an improvisational manner, I've described it as being akin to a jazz drummer who improvises expertly, but improvises nonetheless. This leads to this new identity, not only between Christians and Jewish under the Union Jack, under the English flag, but also English versus Irish, English versus Scots, English versus Welsh, British versus German, German versus Pole, Pole versus Russian, Serb versus Croat. All of a sudden, when they cross the Atlantic, they adopt this new identity, this monetized and militarized identity that is whiteness. And it's really shocking and stunning in 2024 in the United States how infrequently those who are defined as white interrogate that particular identity. As the saying goes in the field, they like to make whiteness invisible. They would like you to think that this is some sort of normalized identity, like Homo sapiens, for example.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's a naturalized identity. It's not a construction.
Right.
And so it's important to recognize that this new identity was essential not only to the subjugation of the indigenous, because you had some very good fighters amongst the indigenous population of North America in particular. And it was a more than a notion to think about subjugating them. And then you add on top of that, the fact that these settlers also became leaders in the African slave trade. And so they're importing these unwilling Africans to be free laborers, to build up the productive forces. And that, in a dialectical sense, is linked with this construction of whiteness. That is to say, there's a dialectical link between the construction of whiteness and anti-blackness, the construction of whiteness and anti-indigenous sentiment. And it turns out that is the winning ticket, because the Spaniards, or to put a fine point on it, His Catholic Majesty in Madrid, was obviously heavily invested in this religious proposition, which was not the winning proposition with regard to the rise of capitalism, for example. Not to say that it was a losing proposition, but certainly it had difficulty in keeping up with the Anglosphere, or as you would have it, keeping up with your Dutch comrades. In Indonesian, of course, the Dutch were first to settle what is now Manhattan, perhaps the capital of the capitalist world, that is to say, New York City. But then that leads to conflicts with London, with the Londoners emerging triumphant. And that context, you see the rise not only of whiteness, but white supremacy. And this new identity, it begins to yield, if I were to fast forward, because of events such as the Haitian Revolution, 1791 to 1804, which, sad to say, people on the left have not interrogated sufficiently, because it's basically a successful revolt of the unpaid sector of the working class in Haiti. And not having objective global conditions, they had difficulty in maintaining the political economy, which of course leads to the 1820s, where they have to pay this huge indemnity to the former enslavers in France, which has crippled the economy up until this very day. I'm sure you're probably familiar with what's happening in Haiti today, with the government has basically collapsed, and there's talk amongst the neighbors about an external intervention, but that's the direct result of the destabilization that it faced. And just one more footnote before I turn the microphone back to you. Oftentimes, even amongst the well-meaning, you have this concept of the so-called Age of Revolutions, supposedly ignited by 1776 with the revolt against British rule in North America, leading to the United States of America, and then linking the Haitian Revolution and the French Revolution to that, despite the fact that with the French Revolution as early as 1792, 1793, before the Napoleonic reaction, you had an attempt to abolish slavery. Obviously, slavery was abolished in Haiti, which is linked to the French Revolution. So linking North America, or linking the United States to those events, is somewhat curious, because in 1776, there were thousands of enslaved Africans under the U.S. jurisdiction, or the incipient U.S. jurisdiction. By 1861, at the time of the Civil War between the slave owners who were trying to overthrow the government and those who were opposing them, there were millions of enslaved Africans. So if that's an abolitionist project, when the number of enslaved rise from the thousands to the millions, I would hate to see a pro-slavery project. I guess they would have risen from the thousands to the billions. But that's the line in the United States right now, even from some of our friends on the left who really should know better, but apparently do not.
Right. Peter, you want to say something?
Yeah, I don't want to like divert it away from the next question you have, but if I could just jump in, I wanted to ask a follow-up question about the Haitian Revolution, because I just read a book on it last year, the year before, and the strong impression I got was one of the kind of tragedy of the global structure that the Haitian revolutionaries found themselves in. So after they win probably the most incredible revolutionary war in history, maybe just period, but certainly up until that point, it seemed from the account in the book that I read that the situation they found themselves in was the actual revolutionaries, the people that won the war against the greatest army in the world at the time, they wanted to have, you know, their own lives on their own farms, be self-sufficient. That's the life that they wanted to enjoy. That's the life that they wanted to win from the revolution. But they found themselves in this extremely hostile global structure with France, the US, all of the European powers. So they realized, since we don't produce our own weapons, we're going to have to buy weapons to keep ourselves well armed to defend our revolution. But then that forces us to engage in trade. The only thing we can trade are the products of the same types of massive plantations that will, you know, get us the hard currency that we can use to buy weapons. And then they were unable to allow for, you know, all of the fighters to have their own lives on their own farms. They had to maintain, you know, these massive scale operations so that they could get the hard currency to purchase the weapons that they needed. I was wondering if you have the same view or a different view. How would you describe the pressure of the global system on the young Haitian Republic after the revolution?
Well, first of all, there's been an enormous amount of scholarship in French and in English. I'll just refer, for the sake of your audience, to the English books on the Haitian Revolution. And I would recommend, of course, the classic by the Trinidadian scholar C.L.R. James, The Black Jacobins. My book, Confronting Black Jacobins, which comes out about 9 years ago. If you go to the aforementioned Activist News Network, you'll find a number of interviews that I've conducted with Haitian and Haitian American scholars on the Haitian Revolution, and also U.S. scholars. John Garrigus, G-A-R-R-I-G-U-S, Professor Daut, D-A-U-T, at Yale, Professor Alexis, A-L-E-X-I-S, at Oberlin College, many others. The long and the short of it is akin to what you described. That is to say, the Haitian Revolution was birthed in a hostile atmosphere. You have a country that even today only has a population of about 10 million, perhaps one-tenth of that at the time of the revolution. They're surrounded by British colonies, Jamaica in particular, Spanish colonies, and they had a particular, I even quoted in the book from a Spaniard, that they really have a particular antipathy and fear of the Spaniards in Cuba, for example. And in fact, that brings us to one of the biggest foes of all, their supposed partner in the Age of Revolution, speaking of the United States of America, which feared the Haitian Revolution. And there was good reason for the slaveholding republic to fear the Haitian Revolution, because there is evidence to suggest that, like successful revolutions and revolutionaries everywhere, they wanted to spread their gospel. They wanted to spread their revolutionary fervor. And so if you look at some of the most significant slave revolts in North America, 1800 Virginia, Gabriel's Revolt, inspired by the Haitian Revolution, 1820, 1821, the revolt led by the sailor, black sailor, Digmark Vesey, V-E-S-E-Y. There's evidence to suggest that he was sailing in and out of Haiti and that the plot was to liquidate the slaveholders and then flee en masse to the Caribbean. And then, of course, attempts to incite slave revolts in Barbados, the British colony, one of the richest of the sugar colonies of London. You can make the argument, in fact, I have made the argument, that when Britain in 1807 decides to ban its role in the African slave trade, part of it has to do with the fact that the ruling class had come to the wise conclusion that it did not make sense to continue bringing grave diggers for this system from the African continent so that they could create havoc in Jamaica, Barbados, etc. And so they were trying to stabilize the situation. By doing so, the United States followed suit in 1808 for similar reasons. But then, interestingly enough, in the United States, this leads to something the scholars are just beginning to grapple with. It leads to breeding of Africans, as if we were like cows and bulls, for example. And even though there has been significant scholarship on that question of breeding, like historians are wont to do, they have not tried to connect that inhumane system to contemporary social mores. That is to say, what has been the impact of forcing copulation between people who barely know each other on the process of social relations and relations between men and women, even to this very day? I mean, this is the culture that was created in this country. As I said, it may be asking too much for historians who study, say, the early 19th century to then leap ahead and speculate or even try to show the impact in the 21st century. And in terms of the hostility to the Haitian Revolution, once again, it reaches a kind of zenith in 1844. Now, if you look at your map, you'll see this curiosity that this island that the Spanish called Hispaniola is occupied by two countries, Haiti and the Dominican Republic. Haiti once occupied the entire island, but as I point out in my book, in one of the early successful ventures in covert action, to use the CIA term, the United States helped to engender a revolt on the eastern side of the island that led to the creation of the DR, the Dominican Republic. And that has also had a curious impact on the culture of the DR. I mean, stop me if I'm going too deep into the weeds.
No, please continue.
Okay. Because the DR is a very curious place. It's one of the few former colonies that actually asked the Spanish to return and colonize because they were so intimidated by the Haitians. This is after the successful revolt of 1844. But not only that, there's a real color complex in the DR. If you go to your search engine and put in the name Sammy Sosa, S-O-S-A. Oh, you know about Sammy Sosa? Oh, yeah. Baseball.
Yeah, he set the single season home run record, right?
Well, I'm impressed. How do you know about baseball? You're from the United States. I thought you were from Algeria or something.
No, I'm from the U.S. originally.
I am half Dutch, half Algerian.
Oh, I see.
Peter looks Algerian, I know.
Okay. All right. So look at the pictures of Sammy Sosa when he set the home run record. And look at the pictures of him today. He had an operation to drain all the color out of his face. So he'll
right.
Look like
I know him. I know him. Yes. I know who you're talking about.
And, you know, that's part of DR culture. And it stems from this sort of anti-blackness, which is an essential aspect of colonialism in the Americas. And of course, that particular trend reaches a rather dispiriting climax in the 1930s when the Dominican dictator Rafael Trujillo massacres tens of thousands of Haitians alongside the border. Haiti has had a very difficult... I would be the last person to suggest, as some of the Christian evangelicals have said, that in the United States have said, that Haiti is being punished because what they did was devilish. Obviously, I think that's poppycock, as they say in London. But certainly Haiti, like the source of many of the enslaved Africans, speaking of the Congo, have had a very difficult trail, very difficult history, a very difficult road to pursue.
Right. Yeah, and I would say that even on the micro level, when we're talking about white supremacy, is also one of the reasons why we learn so little about these things, such as slave revolts. But I would say also, and that goes back to the Middle Ages, but the fact that we hear almost nothing about the occupation of, especially Spain, of the Moors, for example, mm-hmm. and my stepfather, he often went down there because he was literally and he's a typical Dutch guy, by the way, but he's enthralled by the high culture that the Moors brought to Spain. He always loves to check mm-hmm. the architecture. He's really baffled mm-hmm. by it. He really loves it. And I told him, I said, we'll never learn anything about it in Europe, about the fact that these people were there for hundreds of years. You know what I mean?
And actually, I just came from San Diego, California. And if you look at pictures online of Balboa Park, it's all this faux Spanish architecture, which in a sense, as you suggest, is derived from North Africa, for example. Although many of the good people in San Diego are undoubtedly unaware of that.
And would you say that maybe that plays a role in Spain's dubious, you could say, almost schizophrenic role in white supremacy? I mean, the fact that they are already, you could say, kind of mixed. I don't know how many people would like to hear that in Spain, but they have a very different history than most European countries, I would say.
Well, and that has been held against them in the United States, which has taken this color obsession to new highs or new lows, if you like. That is to say that one of the criticisms of Spanish colonialism, my book on Cuba from the U.S. elites, was precisely the fact that they said that they were mixed and that was a certain kind of contamination, for example, which presumably had impact upon their culture, upon their intellectual candle power, and all the rest. That helps to generate the U.S. effort to seize Spanish colonial territory, culminating, of course, with the seizure of California from Mexico post-1846, the seizure of Texas from Mexico post-1836. And these are now the two largest and most populous U.S. states. And then, of course, Florida is number three, which is seized from the Spaniards circa 1820, for example. And once again, the U.S. elites had a certain kind of racism towards the Spanish colonists, which then in turn, I think, was ingested by those who were victimized. An interesting point is that a country with one of the highest per capita numbers of psychiatrists is Argentina, for example, which, you know, I've been to Argentina, I did research in Argentina, and there's a certain nervousness about being considered third world, and, you know, they're neighboring Brazil, which has the largest black population west of Nigeria. And of course, up until about 100 years ago, Argentina was competing with the United States for attracting European migrants. In fact, the joke with regard to Argentines is that they're Italians who speak Spanish and think they're British. I guess you can follow that route. And so, as Mr. Trump might say, the U.S. elites did quite a number on the Spanish and their and the mestizos and the other descendants of Spanish colonialism. And then, of course, the United States finally in 1898 delivers a knockout blow to this tottering Spanish empire by seizing the Philippines, seizing Cuba, seizing Puerto Rico, for example, and virtually that's the final blow to the Spanish Empire, which it started so, quote, gloriously post-1492.
Yeah, that's why I always think it's so important for people to learn our history, because this whole obsession with purity and being mixed and whiteness, if the Northern European was such an exceptionally superior people, then I wonder where were they all these thousands of years before that, you know? So I find that always very fascinating. But anyway, I think Peter has a question, right?
Yeah, I do, but I think actually a follow-up question now would be better. You just mentioned the U.S. imperialism in the Philippines. It reminded me of this line I read somewhere that some U.S. politician said, you know, part of the reason to colonize the Philippines is to Christianize them. And somebody said, but they're Catholic. And then the guy responded, exactly, we need to Christianize them. I was wondering if going back to Kareem's earlier question about white supremacy, you mentioned, you know, Catholicism and Protestantism. Do you think white supremacy, I don't know, either today or perhaps in the broader sweep of history, has any sort of religious tinge, either Catholic or Protestant?
Oh, I would say so. In one of my books, and actually I've mentioned it repeatedly since I wrote it, is that as a person and persons in a former British colony, you're probably familiar with Bloody Mary, Mary Queen of Scots, and the conflict in what is now the UK between Protestants and Catholics, with the losers in battles being burnt at the stake. That's why Mary is called bloody. And then, as I say, by the hundreds of years later, by the end of the 19th century, that is to say, post US abolition of slavery in 1865, you have Europeans who are Protestant and Catholic linking hands to burn black people at the stake, for example, under this new identity of whiteness. And interestingly enough, if you look at the history of colonialism and settler colonialism in North America, just as this person you were just referring to was speaking of this desire to deliver Christianity to the so-called heathens. Well, I would say from the beginning of the English arrival in what they call Virginia after the so-called Virgin Queen, Queen Elizabeth, in the early 1600s, up until the end of the 1600s, they're referring to themselves as Christians and to the Africans and others as non-Christians, as heathens, as blasphemers, etc. But at a certain point, you see a transition, and when they begin to refer to themselves not as Christians, but as white, for example, at some point in the 1600s. And likewise, in my book on the 16th century, I point out that there is an eerie parallel between anti-Jewish fervor in what is now the British Isles before 1492, as I said, expelling that population by the end of the 13th century, and then what's visited upon non-Christians in the settler regime. That is to say that Jewish people were said to have a particular odor, and black people were said to have a particular odor. There were attempts to limit the Jewish role in the political economy. There are obvious attempts to limit the black role in the political economy. Intermarriage between those who were Jewish and those who were Christians was verboten, was taboo. Obviously, intermarriage between those who are African and those who are not, or the European settlers, is verboten. Now, of course, there are twists with regard to that, for example. And part of the twist is right now, United States, there's an ongoing scandal with regard to what are called pretendians. Are you familiar with this scandal?
Yes.
Right. These are folks, particularly on Native American studies in the academy, who say that they're Native American, but they're really not. Native Americans get very upset.
What's this lady's name, the politician who is known for
Elizabeth
that?
Warren, of course.
Yes, exactly.
She's been viewed as a pretendian as well. But this is where you have to draw distinctions between how these oppressed groups are treated. That is to say that in the United States, you have this bizarre one-drop rule. And, it's part of the culture. You almost have to accept it if that's what everybody thinks. So Obama is considered to be black because he has a black parent. It's almost like blackness is contaminating, as opposed to Brazil, where you have these different gradations between black and white in terms of so-called interracialism. But interestingly enough, you can be, quote, white and have Native American ancestry. I mean, it's almost fashionable nowadays. A Cher, the 70-plus-year-old singer, she claims to be Cherokee. I can't think of all of these people. I think Elizabeth Warren also claimed to be Cherokee, and her whiteness credentials were not challenged. But I think this has something to do with the fact that that stems from access to land. That is to say that if these people who are considered white or also have Native American ancestry, that means they can have an easier claim to the land. Whereas if you're you're not considered to be part black, you're either black or you're not. I mean, you could look like Peter. And if you have one ancestor stretching back 15 generations who was African, you're black. End of story. It's almost, it's part of the anti-blackness. Blackness is a contaminant, which then helps to justify exploiting people's labor, helps to justify making people work for free, for example. And also another twist as well, which unfortunately has not been gathered sufficiently in the United States, at least, is that there are also distinctions with regard to national origin in blackness. That is to say that it's true and it's clear that all black people in North America are subjected to a certain kind of racism and white supremacy. However, those who are descendants of mainland enslaved Africans, like my ancestors came from Mississippi, or despise with more intensity. And that's part of the reason why a number of the leading political figures, such as Kamala Harris with roots in Jamaica and India, Obama with roots in Kenya, Colin Powell with roots in Jamaica, which is not to say, I have to say this quickly and rapidly, they're subjected to racism, but there's a particular hostility towards those with roots in this country, paradoxically enough, ironically enough, perversely enough. And I see a twist of that in England as well, because I think that I'm treated better in London than someone from Jamaica or Nigeria, for example. And I think it has something to do with accent discrimination. I'm told that I speak with a US accent, for example, and you have all of this hysteria in UK about accents. But it also stems from the fact that the Jamaicans and the Nigerians, they've been going toe-to-toe with these colonizers. And so, of course, there's going to be more hostility towards them. So it's not just racism, it's also national origin discrimination. I mean, to make it even simpler, I mean, obviously, there might be a more historic antagonism between English and Irish than, say, English and Croats, even though they may all look the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would say, and then that is that cultural aspect, I would say, because if you would ask me, for example, in the United States, you would see that many Arab Americans, for example, are included in the idea of being white. Same with Jewish Americans, by the way. Yeah. But if you would go to my country, the Netherlands, honestly, I think it's better to be black than to be Arab. And that is because we have just an historical, way more orientalist, xenophobic kind of culture towards people from the Middle East than black people, even though the Dutch have a terrible history with regards to black slavery. In that sense, that's almost opposite, you could say, to the racist culture you would see in the United States.
By the way, on the Activist News Network, you can find an interview I did with a Dutch scholar about the slavery in Suriname and in Berbice, and these major slave revolts in the northern coasts of South America against the Dutch settlers that preceded the Haitian Revolution. They had regimes that lasted for a year or so before the Dutch were able to make a comeback and overthrow them in the 1760s.
Never heard of it. Here you can, there you already see how little we know about that kind of history in the Netherlands, but I'll definitely look that up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Peter?
I'd like to ask a question. The book that I mentioned I ordered, White Supremacy Confronted, finally showed up a couple of days ago. My dog got into it as well, sadly. Thankfully, your index is long enough that it saved the pages that I more care about. But in your introduction, I think you did a great job of kind of whetting the reader's appetite for the rest of the book. But one thing really stood out for me, and I wanted to ask you about it. I had recently read Who Paid the Piper, I think was the name of the book.
Mm-hmm. I know that book.
CIA promotion of what they call the compatible left, that is, leftists in Europe that were compatible with the aims of US empire at the time. And in the introduction, you mentioned briefly, and I guess we'll probably get into it in more depth later on in the book, the Black Power movement in the US and how Nelson Mandela at the time kind of drew a sharp line and said, no, we view the world through a Marxist lens, not what these Black Power Americans are trying to sell. And it struck me because it seemed very much in the same vein as the kind of compatible left, but it wasn't, the Black Power movement wasn't included in that book at all. And I'm wondering if I guess in a broader sense for young people on the internet today, I'm sure that there are similar efforts to promote varieties of leftism or what seems like revolutionary and egalitarian, et cetera, but that may be promoted by the US government or other governments because they are they're antiseptic. They're not actually threatening to the imperial project. For especially for young people who are in this internet environment, could you maybe describe a little bit more about what you think of that Black Power movement in the, I guess, second half of the 20th century, and how young people today might try to distinguish actual leftist or actual revolutionary thought from lines of thought that's actually in keeping with or supportive of US empire?
It's very tricky. That is to say, in the United States, the Black population stems from the unpaid sector of the working class. And one of the points that I've tried to make is that there are many commonalities between the wage earning sector of the working class and the unpaid sector, but there are differences as well, differences exacerbated and worsened by anti-Blackness, which I'm afraid to say has penetrated certain levels of the wage earning class. I mean, if you look at the US Civil War, for example, the foot soldiers for the slave owning class were mostly settlers from the wage earning class. And they were fighting to maintain a system of enslavement whereby unpaid workers could undercut them. It's hard to compete against, if you're a wage earning carpenter, if a carpenter is not receiving a wage. So they were basically fighting against their interests, their own interests. And therein, you begin to see some of the contradictions of the US working class, which have persisted to this very day. And given this culture that's created amongst the unpaid sector of the working class, and also given the repeated efforts by some, going back to the founding of the United States and Thomas Jefferson, to expel the Black population because he perceived that they were a threat to national security. They would ally with the Haitian revolutionaries. They would ally with London. They helped to burn down Washington, D.C., the Negroes in London in August 1814. And then many of them escaped on boats to Trinidad and Tobago, where their descendants continue to reside. So the idea was to expel these Negroes. And so then the Negroes come up with the idea, well, rather than being expelled, we'll leave voluntarily. And so that leads to the Marcus Garvey movement of the 20th century, to go back to Africa, for example. And then, of course, you have the rise of Islam-inflected Black nationalist movements, such as the Nation of Islam, which is still with us to this very day, and in some ways is one of the most influential groupings in the United States of America. But as I tell the story, and by the way, my latest rendition of the story will be out in a few months. It's a book called Armed Struggle, Panthers and Communists, Black Nationalists and Liberals in Southern California through the 60s and 70s. So as I tell the story, what happens with the squashing of the Black left, symbolized by the late, great Paul Robeson, the polymath, multilingual. In fact, he spoke Dutch, by the way. Singer, actor, activist. He's just the tip of the spear when it comes to that entire core Black leftists, socialists, etc. That creates an ideological vacuum that then creates favorable conditions for the rise of various forms of Black nationalism, including the Nation of Islam, which is still with us. And of course, they have this conflict with their dissident Malcolm X, who is executed in February 1965. And I think that with regard to South Africa, what we're basically talking about, particularly with regard to Mandela and his comrades, who are mostly coming out of the South African Communist Party, they're coming out of a wage-earning sector of the working class, albeit highly exploited. But you have to draw distinctions between a working class that's unpaid, its roots are unpaid, and a working class that are wage earners. And I think the African National Congress was fighting a struggle of national liberation, and they were not necessarily, to put it mildly, going to find allies in the North Atlantic countries to fight against apartheid. They would be finding allies in the Soviet Union, perhaps China, for example, which then influences them ideologically, whereas the Black folk in the United States are fighting a struggle for equality. That was the stage, equality under capitalism, believe it or not. That was the stage it was perceived. And of course, that worked to a certain degree. A person like myself would not have been able to advance in the university in 1950. And so to a certain extent, that was a successful struggle, a successful stage that we went through to fight against US apartheid, or Jim Crow as it was called. But I think it's also fair to say that many in the ruling class, and even many in the left, they find more problematic Black folk who would like to seize the means of production, for example, to put it mildly, and make international alliances.
Mm-hmm.
Although, interestingly enough, what the U.S. ruling class did, and they don't even realize it, I guess it's understandable since they have false consciousness. You don't expect them to realize these sorts of things. But basically, by crushing Robeson and his comrades, in part because they were allied with the international labor movement, international socialist movement, all they really did was allow for a substitute to rise of Islamic inflected groupings that have ties to Saudi Arabia, that have ties to Pakistan. I mean, so they traded one set of internationalists for another set of internationalists. And I'm not sure if they realized that that's what they did, or even if that was a fair bargain from their point of view.
Yeah.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just thinking, when you talk about what kind of movements would be supported by the CIA or the US government, I don't know when I saw that, but I watched an interesting show on Black Power Media where they actually discussed that you have, on one hand, you have more the internationalist, you could say, activists, Black activists in the United States who are about building alliances, who also care about things such as Israel-Palestine, immigration, etc. But then you also have a pretty powerful movement of Black nationalists in the United States who say, why should we worry about them? They don't worry about us. Let's think about us first instead of those immigrants who take away our jobs. And I would say that kind of Black nationalism would be very popular among the U.S. government, I would say. What do you think, Professor Horne?
Yeah, it's very tricky because even in the Black nationalist sector, you have various trends. I mean, for example, you have the recent arising of these trends. One is called Foundational Black Americans. Another is American Descendants of Slaves. In other words, they are playing upon that concept I already articulated, which is this sort of ingathering of the descendants of mainland enslaved Africans and shunning to a degree Africans with roots in Nigeria, Brazil, Jamaica, etc. And as I said, it's very tricky because on the one hand, there is a special national origin discrimination, even against Black people. But on the other hand, obviously, being outnumbered in the United States, Black people need all the allies that we can get. And it's probably a fair assumption to suggest that there are those in the ruling class would prefer to deal with a Black group that doesn't have any allies because they might be easier to crush, easier to manipulate, et cetera. So it's very tricky. I mean, even in this interview, because I'm not just a scholar and a writer, I'm an activist, and if you're an activist, you have to be a diplomat as well. In other words, some of the people who I'm describing, I have to work with. So I have to choose my words carefully. Otherwise, there'll be a clip on the internet that'll lead to me being isolated politically and, given this is the United States, perhaps even shot.
Yeah, right.
Splittist.
What'd you say?
Splittist.
Exactly. Oh, that's one of the milder things that could be said.
Peter, you had one more question, or?
Oh yeah, we're getting close to an hour. I guess I just would want to hear your thoughts, if you can describe briefly what you think about the current election in the U.S. If you think much of it at all.
Well, yeah, I think about it quite a bit. I wish more people would. I work with a number of political groupings, and one of the ones I was working with the other day, I think, and I understand this because I raised the question of the position, the stance with regard to the elections. And of course, they preferred to talk about the global situation, which I understand because it's more hopeful. It's more optimistic. I mean, it's easier to talk about what's going on in the world as opposed to this dispiriting election that we're facing in the United States, but we have to face it. But unfortunately, I'm not sure if our comrades understand the U.S. political system, because as Hillary Clinton could tell you can win the most votes and lose because of this strange anti-democratic electoral college system that Mr. Trump tried to manipulate on January 6, 2021, and you can't rule out another insurrection in 2025. But what that means practically is that with regard to the election, it's basically 50 plus different elections. It's not one solitary, unitary election. I'm speaking to you from Texas. We already know Mr. Trump is going to win Texas. So why not in Texas build for the future by running a third party candidate? We already know that Mr. Biden is going to win California. Why not build for the future by building an alternative to the duopoly, to the Democrats and the Republicans? It seems to me that that's elementary and simple, but I think that with regard to many of our friends on the left, perhaps reflecting that rather dismissive term you used a moment or two ago of splittism, that they're very much concerned about us being on the same page. And we have a consistent political line amongst all the comrades. However, we're talking about 50 different elections. And so, I mean, it assumes that if there were a one unitary election of the European Union, that the folks in France should operate the way the folks in Hungary do, assuming that the histories are similar, when obviously they're different. So that's one of my major complaints about this U.S. presidential election. And by the way, Mr. Trump, as of today, which is International Women's Day, March 8th, is ahead, not only nationally, but also in some of the key states like Nevada, for example. So a number of my friends are already looking for places of exile. So as they say, keep the lights on for us in Hong Kong in case we show up at your doorstep.
You're always welcome, Professor Horne. So the door is open.
Right. And the lights are on.
Right. Okay. No, it's very serious. I mean, the U.S., the corporate media, the U.S. press has been running these stories about what they call Blaxit, a play on Brexit. Because, you know, black people, you know, are beginning to flee already because we know that we're going to be, we're in a counter-revolutionary moment. I mean, part of the problem is because of a misreading of history and a misreading of this notion of counter-revolution, there is not an awareness of how there can be a counter-revolutionary moment today. And as I said, accomplished by fair means or foul. That is to say, if you don't win at the ballot box, you win in the streets, for example, as was attempted on January 6, 2021.
Yep. Mm. Yep. Well, I guess we're already at the 1 hour, so we'll leave it here. But I always have so much more to ask. But okay, hopefully for the next time. But thank you for coming on again, Professor Horne. That was really great, and like I said, you're a very good. You have a very good effect on our channel, so that's a good thing as well. Like I said, many, many more questions, but that hopefully for some other day.
Yes, and, we can reschedule.
Great, great, great. So I guess for now, I wish you a very nice evening. For us, the day is just starting. And until some other time.
Thank you for inviting me.
All right. And I will send you the link, by the way. Sure.
Oh, please do. Please do.
I will do that. All right.
Any viewers in the U.S. of voting age, check out the Cornel West campaign if you haven't heard of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Cornell's an old friend, and I've been taking heat for supporting him.
Yeah, well, I think he's a breath of fresh air, to be honest, in the whole American political landscape. But okay, thank you, and see you another time.
All right, good luck to you. Bye bye.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.
The truth of the matter is, they don't really give a fuck about anybody if you break the shit all the way down to the low fucking dirty ass truth.
We say that Black Lives Matter, but truthfully, they really never have. No one ever really gave a fuck. Just read your bullshit history books. But honestly, it ain't just black.